Most Canadians consider themselves science literate, according to the Ontario Science Centre's latest survey. However, on closer questioning, many also hold views that run counter to prevailing scientific opinion. Dr. Maurice Bitran is CEO and Chief Science Officer at the Ontario Science Centre, and he joins us now on some popular knowledge gaps. Great to meet you.
Great to be here. Nice meeting you.
How long have you had the job?
A little over 4 years now.
I can't believe I haven't met you yet. This is what surprises me. Okay, it's good to have you in that chair. How scientifically literate do Canadians think they are?
I think we think that we're more scientifically literate than we really are. That's what the survey shows. We think that when asked directly, about two-thirds think that, yes, we're scientifically literate. When we ask specific questions, we see that the foundation is not necessarily that strong.
And science literate means what exactly?
It's a combination of things. It's knowledge of things about science. It's also knowledge about how the scientific method works. And so what you can expect from scientific inquiry and what scientific inquiry cannot give us.
I mean, can you be science literate and not know how many planets there are in the solar system, that kind of thing?
Well, that would speak to the first part, which is about knowing some basic amount of scientific knowledge. But knowledge changes, new planets are discovered.
And some disappear.
Some disappear, are demoted. And so the important thing is to understand how the scientific method works, how we can interrogate nature using the scientific method, and how science gives us answers that are perfectable, never necessarily perfect, but perfectable over time.
Do we seem as a country to be interested in science and how it affects our broader world?
Very much so. We have 83% of Canadians, according to this poll, which was a poll over 1,500 people, who want to know more about science. I think this is great news. And so people have an interest about science, they want to know more, they have a good attitude about science. It's just perhaps they don't have as much knowledge as we would expect.
Well, the way you have it here, you break your survey down into three basic groups: analytical, balanced, intuitive. Tell us about the differences among those groups.
This is part of what the company that did the survey breaks their panel in, and is how people make decisions. So if you make decisions weighing both the data and your values or your intuition, then that's balanced. If you rely mostly on data, they call that group analytical, and if you rely mostly on gut instinct, that's the other group. So I think most of us balance our values with knowledge to make decisions, and that's the balanced group, which indeed is the bigger one in the sample.
So when George W. Bush says, "I met Putin, I looked into his eyes, I got a sense of his soul," that's intuitive.
Yes.
That's not...
That's gut feeling.
That's not analytical or balanced.
Yeah,
okay,
right, yes.
Gotcha. You know, I looked at some of the results, and you know, some of them seem somewhat contradictory. Can I give you an example here?
Please.
Okay. 81% of respondents, which is a big number, 81% felt that most people don't understand the impact of science on our everyday lives. 54% believe that society is turning away from science in favor of ideas that lack evidence or data. What are we to make of all that?
I think the most worrisome result for me is this 54% feel that society is turning away from science. I think the other number speaks to, you know, I think I'm science literate, but I think other people may not be science literate. But if you put that together with another result that says that 74% of people think that we're going to need science and technology to solve the very critical problems the world faces, then you have a point of conflict there. If we need science and technology to solve the problems, yet half of the society think that society is moving away from science, how are we going to solve that? That, I think, means that we need dialogue about science and technology and society, and that's what we do at the Ontario Science Centre.
Well, let's do a concrete example here, because, okay, let me just ask you directly. Genetically modified organisms. What does science tell us about whether anything has been found to make that harmful to us?
The science is pretty consistent that we have not found harmful effects of genetically modified organisms on human health. That doesn't mean that we'll never find them. We haven't found them to date, in spite of a lot of research.
And they've been around for decades.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, and yet, Here's the survey. To what extent do you agree or disagree with the following statement? You want to bring that up, Sheldon? There it is. Yeah. Genetically modified organisms are bad for your health. 53%, yes. The majority agrees. And 19% strongly agree. Yes. What does that tell you?
I think that that shows that some people will rely more on their gut feeling and intuition than on scientific data. And we saw that from the breakdown of the groups. And so that, to me, speaks to trust on science as a way of getting information about the world. And I think that kind of breakdown of trust is really problematic.
Let's do another concrete example. Climate change is big, yes, in the news, obviously. Let's talk about this. Sheldon, you want to bring the next graphic up? To what extent do you agree or disagree with the following statement? The science behind global warming is still unclear. There it is. The science behind global warming is still unclear. 45% agree with that. 14% strongly agree with that notion.
And this is, we've done this survey for 3 years, and this is consistent with last year. I think it was 47%. So it's a significant fraction of the population that are not relying, you know, on science. There are hardly any other subject in science where there's been so much study and so much agreement among scientists about the effects of climate change and the effects of human actions related to climate change. So there is a substantive agreement there, and it's concerning to see so many people think that that's not the case.
Because I think if you were to survey scientists, the science behind global warming is still unclear, you might get 1% of scientists who said, yes, it's still unclear. 99% would say it's pretty clear.
Yeah, I agree with that.
And yet here's 45%. Yeah, yeah, of, I mean, yeah. Does that depress you?
Well, it shows a challenge. I think, and the challenge is that if we're going to need science to solve our problems in the future, yet so many people are not relying on science. To me, that's the crux of the result, the general results that we need to focus on. And it's for organizations that work at the interface of science and society to take this, like science centers and others, to take this right on.
But you've been, I mean, let's face it, the scientific community has been beating the drum about climate change and global warming for decades, never more urgently than now. And yet, in spite of all of that effort, you've got 45% of the people surveyed who think the jury's still out on this. So in some respects, I'm going to repeat my question. How can you not go to bed completely despondent about the problem when almost half the people don't believe it is a problem?
Well, I think that to do what I do, you have to be an optimist. And also, I think there's a lot of reason for optimism in the survey. 83% of people want to know more about science. 90% of people think that science centers and museums are trustworthy source of information. 75% of people think that we need science and technology to solve the problems. So I think we need to look at this, you know, in the overall context. These are challenges, to be sure, and we need to address them. But the overall picture, I don't think, is that bad.
Could it be that 45% are telling the people who did this survey that the jury's still out on climate change because they don't want to pay any carbon taxes or something like that?
We will be in speculative territory, and I don't really know what's the answer to that.
You don't want to speculate because you're all about the science.
Exactly.
You're all about empirically provable data. Okay,
and,
I got
and
it.
It's not that I don't have my own intuition and gut feelings, but mm-hmm. we have to know where's the role where they play. And so where are our values and what does the data tell us and how the two interplay with each other to make decisions.
Understood. Let's talk about, I think, one of the most controversial aspects that science has rendered a verdict on, and yet there is still a stubborn number of people who don't want to go there, autism and vaccination. And I'm going to read something here from the National Post to set up this next graphic. Canada has one of the lowest child vaccination rates in the developed world. With about one-tenth of Canadian children now going unvaccinated, this means that up to 750,000 young Canadians have no immunity whatsoever against diphtheria, whooping cough, tetanus, and measles. Okay, let's bring up the graphic now, shall we? Sheldon, here we go. From your survey, here's the percentage, here's the question. There is a link between vaccinations and autism. That's the question. And science tells us that there is none.
That's been debunked a number of times.
Right.
It was a fraudulent claim to start with.
And there's 19% of people who agree that there is a link between vaccinations and autism.
And that result has been consistent from last year. And not only that, the percentage among millennials who are the new parents is higher. I think it's 27% or so.
Yes, millennials, so 27%.
Very worrisome, with very negative impacts that can happen quickly. I think maybe this generation has not seen the devastating effect of smallpox, of diphtheria, of other diseases, but this is a real societal problem.
Now, that's a good point, because we are decades, many, many decades removed from people routinely getting polio.
That's right.
People experiencing some of these awful things, diphtheria and so on.
That's right.
So it may well be that because we have not experienced this, we're more skeptical. Is that right?
It could be, but I think this is something that we need to take head on, because the impact of this in public health is going to be very significant.
It's more than one out of every four millennials.
Yes.
One out of every four millennials believe that there is a link between vaccinations and autism. What do you do with that?
Well, I think that it's clearly our work is cut out for us in doing more information, more discussion. And also, it should tell us that it's not just facts and figures that convince people. It's dialogue, and there is gut feeling and instincts also mixed with that dialogue. So we need to find new ways to reach people, new ways to have this conversation.
Now, people still get the mumps, they still get measles, there's still research going into all of that. Do you think the fact that this is a present 21st century health problem that could lead the way to people having greater understanding?
Unfortunately, I think when you see the devastating effects of these diseases when you don't vaccinate your kids, maybe then people will realize, but that's too late. Also, it lowers the herd immunity for the whole of the population if people don't vaccinate their kids. So
you should just explain what that. The herd immunity is an idea around vaccination. Because
yeah,
tell people
sure.
What it is.
So the idea is that if you vaccinate enough people, then the germs in that population don't get around, and so there's protection from having a high percentage of people vaccinated.
In other words,
people who have, for example, immune systems that are weak and perhaps cannot be vaccinated are protected by this herd immunity.
Yeah, you don't have to vaccinate 100% of the people to have 100% protection.
Exactly.
But you got to do
pretty high, yeah.
But a pretty good percentage of them do have to be.
Yeah.
What can you do in your role to make Canadians more aware of what the science actually says, not what they think, but what the science, the empirically provable facts say about these controversial issues?
Well, this is what we're engaged in. We are constantly developing new exhibits, and we're planning now for next year, our 50th anniversary, an exhibit on the mind, which tackles how do we make decisions, which is precisely this sort of question, right? And also, we see the influence of family and other sources in the community. So there is a concept called family science capital, and that the more you have people in your family that are related to science, the more you're likely to learn more about science. And so institutions like the Ontario Science Centre are part of this community science capital. Mm-hmm. And so we see about 1 million people a year, 52 million since we opened in 1969, and the more people that come and are exposed to these ideas and then discuss them at home, discuss them with friends, and there is places for dialogue about this, the hope is that will affect this small statistic.
But belief in science, respect for science, starts in grade school.
Absolutely.
And there are too many, I suspect this is the case, I don't know it for a fact, but I suspect it's the case that there are too many young children in our school system who, from grade school on, are afraid of science. Either it's not taught well, or their parents don't know enough about it to reinforce what's learned in the schools, or they're just not into it. What do you do about that?
So we do things like working with the Ministry of Education to train teachers and give teachers some tools. We have programs for families so they can get some more of the information. I think also we need to look at our educational system. Is it okay for kids to drop science in grade 10? Maybe we should look at that. But I think a key point here is to provide teachers of the smaller kids with enough knowledge and comfort with science. So they're not the teachers themselves concerned about teaching something they don't know too much about. Mm.
We have your headquarters, the Science Center, is literally 20 minutes east of this studio. Yes. There's Science North in Sudbury.
Yes.
Do the numbers suggest that people want to attend these places and are into learning more about science?
I think the attendance has been more or less flat for us, and that we attribute that to the fact that there is so many things to do in this great city, and every year there is a new attraction to go to.
Right.
But the fact that we still have close to 1 million people coming every year, over 170,000 students every year coming for school trips, is a great reach. I think there is hardly anybody who grew up in the GTA in the last 50 years who's not been to the Science Center at some point.
Very true.
So that, I think, is pretty significant for the community at large.
Maurice, I don't want to let the media off the hook here either. What responsibility do you think media have to ensure that people are learning empirically provable facts as opposed to, say, you know, what a former Playboy model thinks about the link between autism and vaccines, of which there is none?
But even without going to that extreme, in the media, what bleeds leads. Mm. The soundbite reigns supreme. So how do you communicate a nuanced scientific result when you have to simplify to that extreme? Mm. And how do you communicate the idea that we need to be comfortable with uncertainty? There will be uncertainty. Mm. And so we all have a responsibility to play on this. And it has to do what the scientific method can and cannot give us. And so the more we understand that and the more we're comfortable with that, I think would be a better communication. If people see today in the news, coffee is good for you, and next week, coffee is bad for you, they figure scientists have no idea what they're talking about.
That's a good
point. I better rely on my own gut. And so that's where we, I think, need to work together.
Well, let's finish up on this, because in this era of what do we believe when we read it, what's the source of this information? Sheldon, let's do this graphic one here. The knowledge of science. People, more than a third, get their information from school. And then you can see almost one in five from university. Let's go further down, a quarter from books, magazines, and newspapers. Those better be, you know, reliable sources of information. Yeah. Almost 20%, one in five, the first source mentioned is off the internet. And there's you, 6%, science centers and museums, family and friends, 5%. We don't know how reliable that information is, and then 4% other. As you look at those numbers, what concerns you?
Well, to me, that shows kind of the availability. Everybody goes to school, so, and the first time we hear about science in the school, so it's not surprising that that's at the top of the list. It's encouraging that the number of people that are reading books and magazines is increased slightly from last year. Mm. The internet is ubiquitous, so we all turn to it for questions. But this raises to me the question is, how do you tell what information is reliable and what information is not reliable? And that, to me, points to the need to teach critical skills for people to sort through all this information, decide what sources are reliable, ask the right questions about what's being told, and make up their own mind. And it's interesting that, science centers and family and friends are almost at the same level, but they are among the most trusted. So they may not be that people go to them as a first thing, but are among the most trusted. Science centers, scientists, educational institutions.
I am going to go out on a limb here and say that the information we just got from you is very reliable. And we are glad you came into TVO tonight to share it with us.
We sure hope so, and I thank you for your interest. I think this is an important point for society.
Not at all. Maurice Bitran, CEO and Chief Science Officer at the Ontario Science Center. Go visit it today.
thank you, Steve.
Muchas gracias.
Gracias a usted.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario. Helping businesses stay on the right side of change with strategic thinking, insightful decisions, and business leadership. Are you on the right side of change? Ask an Ontario CPA.